Good evening.
Good evening.
You know, tonight we're here and we're commemorating Juneteenth. For us, we've been participating in Juneteenth for a number of years, but it's still a work in progress. It hasn't grown in acceptance or participation like Kwanzaa has. So we are very hopeful and we will continue on with our commemoration of Juneteenth. And right now, I'll just kind of give you a little statement. I put something on the back of the table that is a history of this celebration. And just for your information, so you can be in the know or have a little bit of background as to this holiday. Now, just a statement from us on our experience wrapped up in our celebration of emancipation, which is truly our 4th of July. Mm-hmm. All right? So in the chronicles of time, African American people have experienced a long and agonizing tribulation. The African were forced into the role of slave and ultimately into the role of the African American. So it speaks to our survival no matter what. It speaks to our determination no matter what. Over the approximate 4 centuries of these metamorphic crossings, we have bore family separation, broken bonds, free labor hours, of course, rape, war, lynching, and imprisonment, which is an ongoing thing, and we think of the industrial prison complex. Millions of African men, women, and children were savagely torn from homelands and traditions, and really, of which we know not where we come from. Mm. So, you know, we can identify, but we have no conclusive evidence to our origin. So we were packed onto ships, many dying, many dispersed all over the so-called New World, which we now know as the diaspora. And although there is no way to calculate exactly how many people were lost, it has been estimated that between 30 to 60 million Africans were subjected to this atrocity that became known as the triangular trade. And that, quite possibly, only 1/3 of that of African people survived. The triangular trade, named because the ships that embarked from European ports, stopped in Africa to kidnap unfortunate African captives, after which they were sent to the Americas to deliver, the Americas to be delivered as human cargo, and then the ships returned to their points of origin. The Middle Passage was that part of the triangular trade that brought the African from West Africa to the Americas, both North and South, and the Caribbean. Now, despite the wretched conditions, inadequate space, poor food, deadly disease, violence from crew members, and death, millions of African captives survived, demonstrating the unconquerable strength and impeccable will. So, Europe's shameful history of forced relocation, the journey of the African from the homeland to the slave markets of the Americas, is one of the most tragic accounts of any time, of any people. But now, still we rise. there always has to be a uplifting point to that type of story. So, in that part of the collective history, it is that part of the collective history which we honor in such a way, Juneteenth, that the chains that of the past, those shackles that physically held us together against our wills, could, now that we think, if we think in metaphor, these chains could, in the retelling, become spiritual chains into spiritual chains that link us and hold us together now, in the future, and into the future. I'm sorry, I wrote this very quickly.
All right.
And that painful middle passage, ironically, turns out to be a connecting link of life, a life link for us living in the inside the continent and in the diaspora. So again, so those chains, yes, they were horrible. But now if we look at that, that's all our collective story, and that should bind us, that should keep us together in one struggle. Always the emancipation, the freedom of African peoples everywhere. So we must break away the bars that hold now, which are the chains, the mental slavery, because that's where we're at right now, the mental slavery, and emancipate ourselves, because as Barb Molly says, none but ourselves will free our minds. So we must continue to pay homage and to tell our story and, in a sense, break every chain. So I'm going to just read a poem that I found that I think, as we grow our Juneteenth, will become symbolic. Like when we do Kwanzaa, we do community, Amira Ahmad's poem. This poem is by Christina Kay, and it's very short. It says, "We rose. From Africa's hearts, we rose. Already a people, our faces ebon, our bodies lean, we rose. Skills of art, life, beauty, and family, crushed by forces we know nothing of, but we rose. Survive we must, we did, we rose. We rose to be you. We rose to be me. Above everything expected, we rose. To become the knowledge we never knew, we rose. Dream we did, act we must, we rose." Okay. So, in any holiday that we do, we understand that we stand on the shoulders of those that have come before us. So in terms of emancipation, in the struggle for freedom, I'm just going to call out a few names that we should be acknowledging, and we should be opening up the portals in hopes that they're here with us tonight. Frederick Douglass, John Brown, Sojourner Truth, William Lloyd Garrison, Harriet Tubman, Susie King Taylor, Bishop Daniel Payne, Sam Sharp, Martin Delaney, the Quakers, Odola Equiano, thank you. Ignatius Sancho, Henry Highland Garrett, Robert Smalls, H. Ford Douglas, all the black soldiers of the 54th and 55th Massachusetts Regiment, the approximate 200,000 black men who served in the Union Army and Navy, Wendell Phillips, Charles Sumner, and these are just to name a few. And I'm sure there are many, many others that waged this struggle for emancipation, Jubilee. So in any celebration, we should always honor those who came before us. we stand on their shoulders. So now, to open up our program, we're going to bring out the Juneteenth poets, all right? They are a collective of artists and activists from New Jersey City University. They use art to activate and empower the many communities they walk. We have advocated to end racism, support people along the LGBT spectrum, and unite our peers via mental health. So without further ado, the Juneteenth poets. Mm.
What's up, y'all? How y'all doing?
All right.
My name is Rashad Wright, and I have been given the privilege of being allowed to lead the group that will be performing with you today. We are called the Juneteenth Poets, and I'm just so happy to be able to amass a group of my friends to come out here and share our art with you. And we gotta make some ground rules first, though. So, like, first, my question is, have y'all ever been to a poetry show?
No.
Okay. I see nods. I see some people nodding, but don't worry. We're going to work with that. So, like, when y'all at a poetry show and y'all hear something that's, like, really nice, really good, that's when y'all snap y'all fingers.
Yeah.
Let me see some snaps. All right, cool. If you can't snap your fingers, that's fine. I got that. But I got something for you, too. Now, if you can't snap your fingers, I want you to say, Y'all can do that? Alright, cool. We're gonna make this work. So basically, the first performer we have coming up for you today is Rakaya Buford. She's an extremely close friend of mine. We work together. It feels like we've lived together because I see her like every day. And I'm a very hard guy to trap, but she's someone that always knows how to find me. Give it up for my sister, Rakaya Buford.
Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
I just want to say I'm so happy to be here. Thank you for having me. Yes, my name is Rakaya. I am a graduate student at New Jersey City University. But most importantly, I'm a black woman, and this is my story about being a black woman. For colored girls that have considered losing themselves when the black woman stereotypes are not enough. This is supposed to be about me, but the truth is there is no me without them. It's funny. I thought the safest place I can ever be in is my mother's womb, but the truth is this is where the battle started. She told the whole neighborhood, y'all, she's about to have a boy. So from day one, I was rebelling against her wishes. My spirituality met with her biology and mixed my psychology with hers. I would like to think me and my mother co-parented, although I will say she did the brunt of the work. I raised my traumatized mother. I saw what love was through her eyes when she didn't feel like she was enough for him. I saw what oppression was through her eyes, sitting at welfare, her caseworker telling her he would break her hand if she touched anything on his desk. I looked up from her lap and gave him 3 seconds of my finger before she could slap my hand down. I saw what strength was through her eyes because I never felt like I didn't have anything growing up. From the outside, they saw the unemployed welfare queen, but I saw someone who was always there, who would take me to play outside, who coached and engaged all the kids around me. I thought I was lucky because she is a strong black woman. My grandma, the teacher, the woman I will always strive to be, she gives so much of herself and still makes it to church on Sunday. Single mother of 6, Jersey City State College graduate, she not only raised her kids but taught a village. For almost her entire life, she held down a job, a household, and parented all of us. I learned what a black family was through her eyes and knew no matter what dysfunction went on, we still had each other. It took me this long to realize the first time I saw her cry was when she couldn't be as independent anymore. that once we were all out her house, her health deteriorated. Our relationship shifted, as this wasn't the first time we both realized she was allowed to live with herself. When I ask her now, what does she want to go do? She sits and stares blankly out her window. I thought I was lucky to have her. I shouldn't have been comfortable with her being a mammy, but she was my strong black woman. These two women gave me my foundation, but they also took it away as they knew I could not be the same woman they were. The female part of my identity was lost on me, and I didn't want to be angry. I didn't know why I had to be angry in the first place. So I came to the conclusion that I can be strong, black, and successful. I started college full-time as a student. I worked as a babysitter. I worked overnight at Target. I paid my own bills. I paid half my mother's bills as she was head of the household. I dropped one job and kept the overnight job. I graduated from college and took a year off to pick up a rotation of jobs as a mentor, a warehouse supplier, a librarian. I went back to grad school, finishing my semester with a 4.0. I wore black excellence like a new jacket, and no one could tell me anything. I was driven, and I was killing it. I was killing it. I was killing me. And I didn't think twice about the chip growing on me. I didn't think twice about the chip growing on my shoulder as I grew bitter about the folks not working as hard as me. I needed something I could see and touch, so I loved to be needed. I took care of everyone else because their wants and beings fulfilled me and validated me as a person. So what is a strong black woman? Is it the mammy, the Jezebel, the queen, the sapphire? They're all present in some shape or form through this one identity. And we are socialized to be proud of it. We're socialized to be proud that our mothers sacrificed so much for us and not for themselves. These pedestals were given to us by a white supremacist society to make us always feel like we as individuals are inadequate and separate from each other, living our own lives, minding our own business. These pedestals need to be smashed today. To be black and be a woman is a dual citizenship. It is to identify and come to terms with the intersectionality and weight of both these identities carry. To grieve because this world was not meant for us. These systems were not meant for us to stay in. That's where the chip on the shoulder comes from. The jealousy, the control, the rage, the burnout. It wasn't until I understood that as a black woman, I was groomed to be conquered. To spread open my mind and body so that all these ships can enter. Friendships, relationships, warships, hardships, ownerships, leadership, citizens. Where is my ship? If you wonder why someone can be so cold, it's because you left the door open. I could stand here today and tell you that I identify as a strong black woman, raised by strong black women, from a long line of strong black women. I am surrounded every day by mentors and individuals of color that make me feel bright. But at the same time, I no longer want to be like them. And I welcome you all to my unraveling. Thank you.
I don't know if y'all was listening. Was y'all listening? Yeah, I see it. Yeah, I need some snaps. All right, cool. So our next performer is ironically another sister of mine. Her name is Jasmine Bryant. I've had the blessing of being able to work with her mainly through music and art. So out of everyone here today, she's definitely seen like a lot of different shades of me, like especially when I was first coming up as an artist, as a writer, and I'm so glad to see her be able to graduate from college and still be able to produce art alongside me, so give it up for my friend Jasmine Bryant.
Introduction. And thank you for those who are providing this safe space for us to share our creations and vibe together. So here is my first poem about a few other things that make me thankful. Sunbeams bless me as the wind caress me, as the air I'm set free, as the earth accepts me. Summer beckoned up my mind's ascension, said goodbye to tension, 'cause I'm fine with friction. Alive with time the universe provides, galaxies of realities cater me kind. We are of the greatest of saviors, human being, sacred time taker, mind shakers. Water flows through me and it moves me. Movement of the earth shifting, cycles of rebirth cause worth. So good that it hurts to be impertinent. Let your purpose shift and work with earth a bit, work in it. With our worth equipped selves, adding water to wells. And avid applicants of adding happiness to our hells. Just releasing of shells, allowing peaking of our internal wealth to add stealth to the stepping. Cater to our wisdom, risen from rhythm of lessons. In the pigment that we're dressed in, blessed in all of our reflections. Question all until the quest ends, and that is with no exceptions. With good intention, and not to mention, connection through expression. Earth be my template for sensing. Earth be my template for health. We symbiotic because the cosmic's my narcotic. And I'm just being honest. Hardly bothered by a conflict because I'm on it. On earth perceiving since birth receiving flows deep enough to leap in because I'm shallow where the deep ends. On the prowl for sensation as a reflex. Proud to be a defect because I'm living cause and effect. And as I let the juices seep in. That I am living, breathing, worth believing it. Gives further purpose of my being to thrive as I love being alive. And I love to perceive with my mind, and I love to be unique on the beat of mankind, because I'm absorbing energy that's blessed to enter me. Now I know what heaven means, it's ahead of me. Go see, reflective. One flip perspective lets you sip from the drip of the cosmic nectar, sweet, sweet. Let your scent seep, sense heat. Essential that your sentient intellect deep. Thank you. Thank you so much. That poem is so like near and dear to my heart because I wrote it last summer after a very long drive spell of just not being driven towards creation. So now, after that, and then writing that, I was like, whoa, I remember my ability, and I just dove into it.
What is the name of it?
It's Sunbeams Bless Me. Thank you. So for the second one, it's a little shorter, and I wrote it because I just felt like I needed to motivate myself, and I wanted to write a piece that really like pumped me up and like made me like feel like, you know, doing things. So here it goes. I said, maybe we could run through the sacred sun. Flowers got the power, you can pick me some. I said, maybe we could run from our problems, maybe figure things out, then we solve them. I said, maybe we could run to the sacred ones in meditation, let the lessons come. Maybe we could run. Maybe we could run towards oneness. Maybe we could run towards oneness. Maybe we can. Fix this to be how we picture. We're equipped with the vision, now we fusion the mixture. Speak truth, because our lips got the power of scripture. Aware of our worth, that's the power we're into. I said, maybe we can start this again. Start a spark that lets man have a heart in her hand. Spark burns to flame as our strength we extend, and we thank in our zen for the blessings, and then, maybe we can, baby, grow through your woes, 'cause you're only human. blossom and through your into your truest. And when we do this, we flow as if fluid just water the ruins, and maybe we can do better things. And when we focus within, we release our defense. No matter the vice we vent through, nourish what we tend to. Be gentle with yourself, it's all in your mental. So yes, we can. Yes, we can make a difference if we different than. @crass_art if you have Instagram. Or find, talk to me afterwards. I'm here, so peace.
Don't y'all stop clapping because I'm on this mic now. Y'all better keep clapping for that girl. We don't keep it rolling with the hits. And because, you know, we just out here, bam, boom, bam, hits, boom. And our next writer is, of course, another sister of mine. Her name is Shalisha Cook. And she's seen me grow, like, outside of art. She's seen me grow as a person. Seen, like, all the humanity in me come back to me. She's seen me in my dark days and my light days. And I've seen her on hers. And we just sort of struggle with each other and just sort of bring out the best of each other every time we see one another. And she's graduating this semester, so it's gonna be a little hard for me not to have my sis around the same way she used to be, but I got her right now, and she helps me bring out my art, so I'm gonna help her bring out hers. Right. Give it up for Shalisha Cook. Woo! By the way, she is debuting a reading from a book of poetry that she has written.
Hello. Rashad has several chapbooks, so I decided to make my own chapbook. He actually motivated me to make my chapbook, and it's called Botanicals for the Black Soul. I have 5 copies with me. Actually, they're $5, and so I was like, oh, you know, I should put a compilation of my works together. So I'm gonna read something from it. And if I have time, I'll read another one. That's like on my heart right now. They told me that I must hide my voice in these empty rooms. Lay silent as they strip me bare, but never let these emotions flow. I am not your stepping stool or your good girl. You cannot rip out my vocal cords and place them in your box labeled invisibility. You see me. You all see me. And I feel rage when you tell me that my silence is more important than the language of my soul. I feel deeply. The air is thick and we're all pretending to breathe. The rain is cold. You know what to do. The rumble of the bottom of it says enough. The branches still sit in attention. You want to speak, but you don't know who will listen. Your voice alone can save your soul and souls of those who hear it. Complicate the way they talk about you. Her bark, it bites. Her fears, she fights. When lips and tongue and teeth and heart and head and heart and heart move, yes, you are that you. You are that you. I want you to get it the way I get it. I need you to see it the way that I see it. You have to speak. You have to breathe again. So I'm gonna do, this piece is called Frozen. They sat frozen in silence, replaying in their minds the signs that normalize this misery. See, history colonized black minds with an inferior plague offset by the inheritance of untreated wounds left scenting the wind. Imprints of tattered flesh and scar limbs engraved unnamed rage deeply into spirits, spilling into wombs that hallowed all consolation of freedom, expelling us in a comatose essence, completed by the eternal battle of the double conscience.
I'm going to call up my brother, who's already up here, so I ain't gotta do much calling. My homie Ezinwa Wosu on my right, not my left, cause this is on my right, always been right, I've never been wrong. This is my homie Ezinwa Wosu. he's sleep. This is my homie Ezinwa Wosu, and we actually have the privilege of being in a band together. So like this is my first time like really working with music and poetry and rhythm and all that, and I need someone to show me the ropes because I do not know it all. So I got my homie Ezinwa Wosu. All right.
Ezinwa, you can call me Ez. I'm gonna be singing a song called September. Thank you.
And we not done yet. We got one more artist. I love this brother. I grew up with him. He's known me since before I could read. His name's Rashad Wright. And he's a poet, an activist in Jersey City. He does competitive poetry, whether it be Jersey City Slam. And he's a peer educator, so he helps out the community at NJCU. He's a lifeguard, he coaches a poetry club. He's a real community guy. And I'm gonna call him up and then he's gonna do like this piece for y'all. And it's not really a poem, cause like, you know, lately people haven't really been too fond of poems. Cause you know, poems are always like really dark and people don't really like dark things. I should know I'm usually like the darkest thing in the room. Like this living, breathing metaphor just sort of walking around in a pile of flesh. So I'll just hold my breath because I know there may be a plot twist waiting for me on the other side of an exhale for a poem. Survival for just one more day is always the best plot twist, so I'm not going to be a poem. Poems are often too short-lived. They're not going to be short-lived. I'm gonna have a happy ending and it's gonna be beautiful. It's gonna have afros and roses and there won't be any poems that can't love the things they give birth to. I don't need no poems all dead and stuff on my sidewalks with their candlelit curbside caskets. There won't be any poems in jail or sick or misdiagnosed or lynched or raped or robbed or shot or murdered. You won't be crying over any poems in this piece. I said this piece is gonna have so much love and basketball in between its lines. I know, right? And it's gonna sound like it was written by someone's uncle at the cookout. And that's because it's gonna have a few cookouts in it. A tipsy electric slide and at least three cousins you never even met before. And this piece might be bald-headed, and this piece is gonna be as bald-headed as it wants to be, because you know, what this piece does with this body is none of my business.
All right.
And you know, this piece does the best it can with what it has. And this piece, yeah, it's gonna sound like a poem. And it might even be a poem, but I'm not gonna let you call this piece anything other than its name. Because this piece, I mean, I will share my name with you, will give myself to you when I'm good and ready.
Hey. All right.
Now it's over.
So now we're going to bring up Sister Mary Aiken, and she's going to do a little song, a little bit of poetry, no? Song, and she's gonna include the audience in her presentation.
In my storytelling.
In her storytelling, that's a better word, storytelling. Mary is a vocalist, jazz. She's a children's entertainer, educator. She is a artist, arts and crafts. She does beautiful work, and she's been at it for a very, very long time. And one thing that I'm very happy to say, she's brought my son, Samora, into her world, into her storytelling, into her interaction with children, and they are quite formidable when they get going. So, without further ado, Mary, and again, she's going to ask you to participate.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I'd like you to give them a hand. So not only is this workshop about coming out of slavery, but it's also about learning about other people's heritage, about different cultures. And there's a culture that a lot of people don't get into. It's called sign language. And I want people to learn sign language because it's so good when a deaf person hear you and know that you know just one word in sign language. It's so important. So the song is called The world is big. Say that.
The world is big.
And this is the world. Make a W. W. The world is big. The world is small. There are lots of room for the short and tall. The world is far. The world is wide. There are many ways to see the other side. You could travel on a boat. You could travel in a plane. You could travel on a bus. You could travel on a train. But the world won't be the same. The tune that goes like this. Oh, the world is big.
I'll find out why that they don't want to join us.
because I'm really curious as to why they don't come. Mr. River, would you come out? I have a question for you. Why is it that you don't come and join us? I try to be friends with you, and you just, I just don't understand it. Would you explain for me? Mr. River thought for a while and said, you know what? I listen to you singing all the time. I watch your beautiful outfits, and I see you with all that good food, but I just don't understand your culture. I don't understand what it's all about. You know, maybe if you explain it to me, oh, you know what? If you come to visit me, then maybe we can sit down, you bring your family, and we can sit down and we can talk about the different things in our culture, and we can share different things. So the river said, well, then again, you know what? Your house is really small. You have to build a new house because look at all these children that I have. They won't be able to fit in your house. Oh, you know what? We'll just build a new house. No problem. We'll do that. So the son hurried home to his wife and his family. The beautiful moon and the wonderful stars. Let us begin with many of my family to build a house that's at least twice as large. The beautiful moon and the wonderful stars. And then they began to build the house. They came the wall.
Oh, yeah.
chest and say to Kekekore.
Thank you. That's okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
I can't see your face, but.
So we have children,
Rashad.
Oh, Rashad. That means we're on the right path. That means somebody who's directing on the path. All right? You can't fall. Okay? They come from the word Rashid. Some brothers say Rashid. Okay? The dance that we were inspired to do is called, well, it's done in three parts. Only old heads from back in the day know that. Right, Ben? Because yeah. They go from one to the second one without the middle. And what happens is, the slow methodic is the enslavement. It's the chains and the movement of, in order for you to go forward, you gotta look back. That's Sankofa. Let me go get your stuff, go back. All right? And the quivering, even though a lot of brothers and sisters who are from Africa, like right now, when I say right now, 50 years and under, they don't have a clue of what it is that our ancestors interpreted it to be once they got from the water here. All right? So they may not understand the word enslavement as we do, or slav. But it meant, in their nation, you were indentured. So this is the beauty and the ugly of it. You're still on the continent, you're still eating food, you're still wearing your clothes, you're still doing your rituals. And you might be working for somebody like they're doing right now. 10, 11, 12 year olds working in somebody's house for maybe $10. If they don't even, they don't be $10 a month. Understand me. That's the same thing as us here for no money. But the difference here is we lost the language, we lost the clothes, we lost the ritual. It wasn't our land, okay? So we had three things really totally against us. And then, to top it off, people from there don't understand. The same monsters that took the land from them took us off the land. Okay, so you have to look at it, it's the same thing. But because people who are still left at home, they're more sometimes enslaved in their mind as to who we really are. We are the real Sankofa people, we're going back. Sometimes we're more back than they are with their stuff. Sometimes we have studied more hardly than they have, because they think, how many times have you gone to Statue of Liberty here? Right. You're here every day, so people who come here, they think you're going all the time. No, we didn't come waving. We didn't come standing up waving. So what we have to understand is their understanding and misunderstanding is based on the circumstances that they were brought through. Okay, and so our circumstances, being similar and sometimes the same, it works out checking balances. We've been in a servitude position all of our existence in this nation. All right? So we don't need to get it twisted. And we don't need to think that we are feeling guilty about claiming something. Everybody didn't come here from the continent. But this is what I'm telling you, the continent is in the middle of the world. And everything came from the continent out. Okay? That's the brain. When you look at the whole continent of Africa, it's bigger than all the rest of the stuff. They make it small. But they put it in a strategic place in the middle. That's the nucleus. Okay? Anybody in science here with me?
Yes.
It's in the middle. And it generates everything from the center out. Okay? Like a baby in a womb, balled up. Look at it. It's shaped like a baby in a womb. It's shaped like a brain. So people who know truths. And if you let the truth be told, everybody walked up out of the continent. Okay, Mr. Leakey will tell you that, him and his whole family. So we have to understand that. So when we dance, some of the people in church, they praise dancing. If they really knew what that fabric was about, if they really knew what they was bringing down and calling down, if they really knew the tongues and stuff that they're speaking, okay? So we have to understand. Those of us that's in this room right now, you gotta get your job done. We can't keep passing stuff. You know, oh, you're right back there. Where are we gonna pass it to? A Trumpette? Okay, we don't need no more Trumps carrying nothing. Okay, we have to understand who and what's going on here. So the first part was the servitude, the change. The middle part, you had more freedom. Even though you was on the plantation, you couldn't go nowhere. You had no money. You wasn't going nowhere, you couldn't leave. So now you're growing the same potatoes on the same piece of land, but guess what? you're still on that same land that you were being enslaved to. And you got no money. So for those brothers and sisters who saved up the little bit they had, and you had to know it was little by little, to buy it land so they could at least move. All right, so we're talking two generations staying there, three generations staying there. And then they finally get some children where they can move, they move. So that movement, so you saw movement like the Charleston. That movement, dun, 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 dun. Okay? That's that Charleston that they did back in the 20s. That's that moving. What's the one that went over the water? Lindy. Charles Lindbergh, right? He hopped over the ocean. That's when they was doing the Lindy hop. That was some other people. We used to do a jitterbug. All right? I'll dance quick, fast. Boom, boom, boom. Up in the sky, underneath the legs. All of that. But that Lindy was giving a little bit more movement to them. All right? And so we didn't just hop. We leaped and we soared. And it was like, oh my God, what are they doing? Okay, so when you see that fast movement, hands are free, chains are going, legs are kicking.
Yeah.
All right, that's what that freedom is. So now we can move and do whatever we want now. What's happening? What's locked down now? The brain. The brain. Okay, so just understand, there's a reason for the rhyme. There's a reason for the rhyme. And so the Jean Dome is the first part, and then the Wall of Sedon is middle, meaning you have access on the land movement, but you really can't leave. And then the fast one is, if y'all go see that movie, get out, run. Go, okay? Don't be, okay? You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because you can't get nothing back to you. Okay, just gotta go. So we have to look at that in terms of our children. Okay, a lot of people have been coming for a long time. He was a baby, right? Look, you see they're big up now, right? They ain't paying no rent, but they're getting big. So I just want you to know that's the servitude part. You gotta put something back now. Okay? So what we have to know is pass it on, understand there's a name, and understand there's a circumstance. And if you can't come up with a traditional name for it, guess what? Make it up. Make it up and give it a definition. And pass it on, okay? Because they don't know that you made it up because they really don't know. Just use it enough, okay? We're gonna ask for a little audience participation after this. We're gonna do what they call, I don't know if you feel like playing the Majani now, or y'all wanna do that? Yes, no? Okay. No, I just want y'all to get a little break. But see, I see the hands when y'all believe and stuff, and they're hungry. Grains, ooh. Okay, yeah, okay. So we're gonna ask you to free up your spirit, because see, you know, I'm trying to learn how to play the spoons. Next time I come, we gotta get somebody to play the spoon. Remember the spoons and washboard? Mm-hmm. See, we gotta go back to that. Mm-hmm. We gotta go back to that. So please remind me, because you know, last year you wrote something in the book. Remember last year? Yeah. You wrote some things in the book? I'm gonna read what I put it into the form. I brought it back this year, so for those who wrote, write down some words and I'll use them and I'll put it in a nice poet form, okay? And that's what I did from last year. And wrote it down and wrote the book, okay? We're gonna do what some call it sole, but there's a different definition in sole with the music emphasis. Most people call it Majani. And it's done in the west coast of Africa. It's done in Guinea, it's done in Senegal. They do it in Mali, but sometimes it's a little more flavorful because people from Mali are very more spiritual. People from Guinea, they fly. They don't stay on the land too long, they just gone. So we have to know that when you feel like you just wanna go, that's where you go. Okay, act out. Act up, all right? And if you don't want to come up on the stage, fine, but you can come up on the stage, okay? And you can give us what it makes you feel like, okay? There's no wrong, okay? There is no wrong in this. We just lost a big master. We just lost a big master, Chuck Davis. The two they need me. One day was before that, and Zenobia right after. Listen to me, there's a whole lot of names that we can call.
Yes.
But will we ever hear our goal?
Amen.
Amen. Will we ever hear that again?
Yes.
You understand? So we got to cherish that. And if your children don't know about it, you better say it, because they need to know why we say it. Okay, that big, big man could dance like he was a butterfly. And so for him to be, 6 feet, 7, 8, and weigh over 200 some pounds, close to 300 pounds, is that right, Ben? Mm-hmm. And leave him down. There is no excuse. Okay, so move it, shake it, roll it, whatever you got to do. Okay, and we're gonna play with Johnny. Okay, we'll come out and do some stuff. You come up. If you wanna come up and do some stuff, please do. Okay, put, move whatever. There is no error. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
on which we stand, on which everything is built. So, we are going to spread the news. Slavery is over. Mental slavery, we must free our minds, because nobody else is going to do that for us. So, the black candle, which represents faith, which represents the people, is going to light the candle that is going to light all the candles in the room. So one candle is going to go to the next candle, is going to go to the next candle, until all the candles are lit. We're spreading the news that slavery is over.
people were timid, some people were short words, but the words that they wrote, one started with strength, dynamically strong. Wrong can do no wrong. Harm will no longer be harmed. Love, happiness, peace for all. Let everyone come together. Don't let any of us fall. Let everyone come together as it was meant to be. Remove the hate, the envy, and the jealousy. Love thy neighbor as you would yourself. Peace and joy and happiness is the order of the day. Love and happiness is the only way. Enjoy the music and the show. Let's advance together, do what we know. So share the evening with your smiles and your souls, like jewels on the surface of the sea, notes of Neptune's symphony. Together we stand, divided we fall. So falling and fall is not an option. It's not an option. It's not an option.
Juneteenth commemoration, Jubilee.